Once again, greetings to all in the holy and matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For today's meditation, that is September 29, 2021, I'd like to request each one of you to read 1 Kings chapter 1. 1 Kings chapter 1. I'd like to request you to pause this video and read this text individually. 1 Kings chapter 1. I hope all of you have read it. The transfer of regal authority from David to Solomon in 1 Kings chapter 1 is messy. One of David's son, Adonijah, confers with Joab, the head of the military, and tries to take over. Bathsheba, Solomon's mother, reminds her ailing husband of this promise that Solomon would be the heir, and the complicated account plays out. Once again, the chronic family failure of David stands up. The author of 1 Kings draws it to our attention in the parenthetical comment of chapter 1 verse 6. Referring to Adonijah, who was attempting the coup, he remarks, his father had never interfered with him by asking, "Why do you have to behave as you do?" He was also very handsome and was born next after Absalom. As if good looks bred a kind of easy arrogance that brought everything, including the crown itself, was by his right. Of the many important lessons, we may highlight majorly two. First, even gifted and morally upright believers commonly manifest tragic flaws. Occasionally, a Daniel arises, of whom no failure is recorded. But most of the best in scripture betray flaws of one sort or another. Abraham, Moses, Peter, Thomas, and not least David. The reality must be faced, for it is no less potent today. God raises up strategically placed and influential leaders. The odd one is so consistent that it is very difficult to detect any notable fault in line. But usually that is not the case. Even the finest of our Christian leaders commonly display faults that their closest peers and friends can spot, whether or not the leaders themselves can see them. This should not surprise us. In this fallen world, it is the way things are, the way things were when the Bible was written. We should therefore not be disillusioned when leaders prove flawed. We should support them wherever we can, seek to correct the faults where possible, and leave the rest to God. All the while recognizing the terrible potential of failures and faults in our own lives as well. Secondly, once again, the sovereignty of God works through the complicated efforts of his people. When David is informed of the problem, he does not throw his hands into the air and pray about the situation. No. He immediately orders the decisive, symbol-laden and complex steps be taken to ensure that Solomon ascends the throne. Trust in God's sovereign goodness is never an excuse for inactivity or indolence. Long years of walking by faith have taught David that whatever else walking by faith means, it does not warrant passivity. If we are to avoid acting in defiance of God or in the vain efforts to be independent of God, we must also avoid the pietism that is perennially in danger of collapsing trust into fatalism. May God bless you all.